Hi there, and welcome to this lecture on process flow diagrams, equipment symbol representations. My name is Marina Miletic. You may have seen these symbols before. These are heat exchangers, sometimes also called exchangers. If they're used to cool down a process stream, you'll also hear people refer to them as coolers or chillers as well. Heat exchangers have the letter abbreviation E. Unlike furnaces, heat exchangers rely on convective or conductive heat transfer across the surface and not combustion of flammable gases. Let's look at these two symbols more closely. This symbol is a general shorthand representation for a heat exchanger. There are two streams which go through a heat exchanger. One is represented by the black lines and the other with the gray. This black line zigzagging through the circle represents the utility stream. It's the job of the utility stream to heat up or cool down the other stream. The gray lines represent the process stream, which is whatever you're making or in the process of making. This stream is important because it's something you'll probably be reacting, separating, and eventually selling. This configuration represents a liquid or gas utility stream going through a tube or series of tubes, which heats up a liquid or gas process stream. In this configuration, the liquid or gas phase utility stream is cooling down a liquid or gas phase process stream. Let's next look at some typical utility streams. There are about 8 common utility streams you'll see in a process flow diagram, and they each have a unique lowercase abbreviation. They include cooling water, abbreviated CW, which is water that comes from a cooling tower and should be around 30 degrees centigrade when it enters the heat exchanger. Refrigerated water, abbreviated RW, which is water that's at a temperature of around 5 degrees centigrade going into the heat exchanger. Refrigerated brine, abbreviated RB, which is a dissolved salt in water at a temperature of around minus 45 degrees centigrade going into the heat exchanger. Low pressure steam, abbreviated LPS, which is saturated steam around 140 to 160 degrees centigrade going into the heat exchanger. Medium pressure steam, abbreviated MPS, which is saturated steam around 180 to 200 degrees centigrade going into the heat exchanger. High pressure steam, abbreviated HPS, which is saturated steam around 250 to 270 degrees centigrade going into the heat exchanger. Electric heat, abbreviated EL, which uses either 220, 440, or 660 volt electricity to resistively heat a stream. And lastly, heat transfer medium, abbreviated HTM, which usually involves using a high boiling point hydrocarbon to heat up a stream up to around 400 degrees centigrade. There are also a few other utilities you might see in a process flow diagram which don't have a specific letter abbreviation. Here are some examples of how these letter abbreviations should be used as labels for utility streams. Notice that the outgoing stream is not labeled since utility streams are only used for heating or cooling. When specifying them on a process flow diagram, something to keep in mind about all utility streams is that their temperature change across the heat exchanger should be greater than around 5 degrees centigrade, but not more than about 15 to 20 degrees centigrade. The reason for this is that if these streams are heated up or cooled down too much, this puts too much of an energy burden on equipment supplying the utility stream. In other words, the energy-intensive equipment involved in maintaining this utility stream would not be designed or used optimally. Also, a difference in temperature of less than 5 degrees for a utility stream would require an excessively high utility flow rate. This would mean that we would need to purchase a larger than necessary steam boiler or cooling tower because the temperature is only increasing or decreasing by a couple of degrees. So in order to achieve the desired utility temperature change, increase or decrease the flow rate of that utility stream. Do this until you see that you're using just enough of that utility stream to create the desired temperature change. Keep in mind that the purpose of some of these utilities are to undergo a phase change and either absorb or release a lot of heat. This heat exchanger is a good representation of one you would see out in a plant environment. Shell and tube heat exchangers are important because they're the most common type of heat exchanger used in large liquid or gas process plants. If you've ever taken a tour of a chemical plant, you've probably encountered at least several of these. Shell and tube heat exchangers have two separate routes called sides for the two different streams. This route is called tube side because fluid flows through the inside of tubes and transfers heat with the other route called the shell side, where the fluid enters and surrounds the outside of the tubes to either cool or heat them. In this configuration, a hot fluid flows through the tube side and transfers heat to a cold stream moving through the shell side. You might wonder, if you have two separate streams, how do you decide which one is sent through the tubes and which one is sent through the shell? A common myth is that the hot fluid should always go through the tube side and the cold fluid through the shell, and this is wrong. Because the tubes can accommodate extreme pressure conditions better, corrosive, fouling, high or vacuum pressure fluids are usually sent through the tubes. So high pressure steam might be a good example of a fluid that's sent through the tubes, while the process fluid would be sent through the shell side. Fluids that need to condense from vapor to liquid and viscous fluids are good candidates for the shell side. A good example of this would be sending the vapor from the top of a distillation column through the shell side of a condenser. Cooling water could go through the tubes and the vapor process stream would condense on the surface of those tubes. Let's look at some other heat exchanger representations. These three are what you might see in a ChemCAD simulation. The first two are what I would consider general, quick and dirty heat exchangers, and the third is a more realistic two-stream heat exchanger. The gray lines for these heat exchangers are the process fluid, and the red lines are the utility stream. Notice that just because the red lines are drawn to look like tubes inside a heat exchanger, be sure to remember that utility streams are not necessarily tube side. You should decide which stream is tube or shell side based on the chemical property guidelines. Let's look at these first two heat exchangers more closely. This upward pointing utility stream arrow means that this heat exchanger has a utility stream whose job is to cool down the process stream. The cooling water comes out at a higher temperature than it came in, so this is why the arrow is pointing up. This heat exchanger has a downward pointing arrow, which means it has a utility stream whose job is to heat up a process stream. A good example of this would be steam. It's sent through the heat exchanger to heat up a process stream, and it comes out at a lower temperature. Like ChemCAD, Aspen also has these two types of heat exchangers. One is a more general representation, and the other is a more rigorous two-stream heat exchanger. You might wonder how you can set up these heat exchangers so that they have a utility stream such as cooling water or steam going through them. Remember that these are simple heat exchangers. They're meant to be very fast and easy to set up in a process flow sheet. For this reason, you don't connect any utility streams to them. For this type of heat exchanger, there's no way to specify which utility stream you'd like to use, its temperature or flow rate. The purpose of this type of heat exchanger in ChemCAD or Aspen is really just as a placeholder. I suggest you use these generic heat exchangers carefully. Believe it or not, both ChemCAD and Aspen will allow you to heat up a stream to 10,000 degrees or cool down to near absolute zero using a generic heat exchanger like this. It's your job to go back and eventually replace these heat exchangers with ones that are better representations, such as the two-stream heat exchangers you see here. You can see with the more rigorous heat exchangers, you actually have to specify two streams coming in and going out. And depending on the properties of these streams, you may not be able to achieve your desired process temperature. You'll need to vary the flow rate of the utility stream or use a utility stream with a different starting temperature to optimize your heat exchanger. Remember that heat exchangers are there to achieve the optimum process temperature for other more important pieces of equipment, and they're there to help keep the stream at a safe temperature. Design your reactors and separators first because they're the foundation of your process, and then go back and replace the generic heat exchangers with more realistic versions.